to Beyond the Script. Where you find great movies and great conversation. Let's start the show now. The movie we're discussing today is A Few Good Men with Tom Cruise, Jack Nicholson, and Demi Moore.
Ever served in an infantry unit, son?
No, sir.
Ever served in a forward area?
No, sir.
Ever put your life in another man's hands, ask him to put his life in yours?
No, sir.
We follow orders, son. We follow orders or people die. It's that simple.
So excited for our guest today. Stephen Hale is a veteran of the United States Navy, a PR professional, and teaching pastor of Zion Church in Anaheim Hills. Stephen is a native of Texas. He holds a master's degree in communication studies from CBU and a certificate of completion from Texas Bible Institute. He has been married for 11 years and has two children, and we welcome him on today. I'm so excited to be here with Stephen. I told you a little bit about him earlier, but the movie we're talking about, as we already discussed, is A Few Good Men. Mm-hmm. Okay, so I feel like this movie is so impacted in so many different ways, but mm-hmm. as a person that has never known what it's like to be in organized, to be in leadership, to be in something as the Navy, the mm-hmm. Army, the, you know, This is a whole different kind of world right. for the rest of us.
Right.
So this is the reason why I chose you, because Good. You can kind of give us some insight on what it's like to be in that world,
yeah.
as well as being a man of God mm-hmm. in that world.
Mm-hmm.
So let's start with the first half, when it's unveiling what the issue is
right.
in this movie.
Yeah, so what you find here is there's been an accident, depending on which side of the aisle you're on. Was it a murder? Was it not? And that's right. what they go to trial for.
Mm-hmm.
Ironically, the way that this happens is this seems to be a big cover-up. And so what they do is the military in this situation, the installation, the group of Marines that are down in Cuba, they're looking to kind of brush this under the rug, and the case falls to this junior attorney, right? This
right.
junior attorney who right. has a history of plea bargaining.
Yes.
That's what he does, which
yeah.
is kind of what they're looking for, mm-hmm. hoping to have this thing kind of swept under the rug and nobody's going to talk about it, and we'll just kind of move on.
Yeah.
And so the first part of the movie is just trying to like introduce that component to the viewer, and I think mm-hmm. a little bit of what it does is shows type of the power that this organization has, the organization
right.
being like the general, right? He's
uh-huh.
he's a big general he's got plans,
right.
and big government has plans for him.
Right.
So they're not going to let this little incident, you know, derail those plans.
Right, right.
So
right.
let's get this kind of swept under the rug, and let's get it pushing, and let's get moving.
Exactly.
And then we have Tom Cruise, who suddenly grows a conscience.
Yes.
And now he has to deal with that.
Yes.
Yep.
And what stood out to me is what prompted him to grow a conscience
mm-hmm.
was the fact that it shouldn't be this easy
right.
to pretty much just take somebody's life.
Right. He has an epiphany mm-hmm. in the middle of this movie that is basically saying, why is it that this case of this magnitude
mm-hmm.
that could potentially be a murder case, right?
Exactly.
Why is that being given to me,
mm-hmm.
where I have a history of taking the easy way out?
Right.
I have a history of taking, you know, these plea deals.
Right.
And
not having to work.
And not actually having to do
yes.
the work,
uh-huh.
right?
Because, uh-huh.
You know, whatever your opinion is about an attorney, a good attorney is somebody who gets in there and fights for their client.
Right. Right.
right?
Mm-hmm.
I think the funny part about it was there's a scene in the beginning of the movie where he has basically no information about this case. He's got like three facts, and he's already talking about how he can negotiate, you know, this plea deal.
Right.
And but then he has this epiphany later where it's like, oh, actually, I'm going to have to put in some work on this. And it's a little odd that people are used to the fact that I am
yeah.
I'm known for taking the easy way out.
Yeah,
here.
Yeah.
So I thought that was a good moment. That was a powerful
exactly.
moment in this
exactly.
movie.
Okay, so now we're moving on mm-hmm. to, let's say, mid mid-movie, mm-hmm. where he's, our main character, of course, is Tom Cruise, and he is full aware at this mm-hmm. point. I'm fully aware that you're trying to cover this up.
Yep.
What are you trying to cover up and why? Now, what did, you know, your wheels start turning mm-hmm. in the premise of how do you find God in this moment? Now, I'm mm-hmm. fully aware now. You
right.
know, at first it was a question.
Right.
Now I'm fully aware.
Well, I think, so what I kind of relate out of this is, before Tom Cruise believes that, you know, his character in the movie, Lieutenant Caffey, mm-hmm. before he realizes that his client is innocent, mm-hmm. he realizes that there is a cover-up.
Right.
I think that's an important thing to like delineate in this particular movie.
True.
It's kind of like how when we talk about like what God does for us, what the Holy Spirit does for us, we have little checks and balances in our spirit mm-hmm. whenever we know things. Where
right.
you just kind of like, something's not right here. Mm-hmm. You know, something doesn't line up.
Yeah.
There are obviously moments where we have our personalities that go, I don't feel right about this, or that looks fishy to me. But there are things that the Holy Spirit kind of does for us that, you know, you can kind of hear the voice of God sometimes just saying like, hey, you should take pause with that.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of red flags here. And we don't always have the answers to this, right? We
yeah.
might not know that our quote unquote client is innocent yet.
Exactly.
But we have these checks in our heart. We have these checks in our spirit
mm-hmm.
that's like, hey, you need to pause on this.
Right.
Why is it going down this way?
Right.
There's something that's not connecting the dots. And
right.
I think that was kind of like the thing that I found interesting about this movie was, it's almost like there's this big check.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not trying to over-spiritualize this military movie,
right.
but there's this huge like pause, like, wait a second, why is all this happening?
Mm-hmm.
Something must be going on behind the scenes
exactly.
that I don't know about.
Mm-hmm.
And it's becoming obvious. Then what does Tom Cruise do? Then, you know, his character, Lieutenant Caffey, he goes into the nuts and bolts of this case.
Exactly.
And now he's finding these things.
Right.
Now he's searching for it.
Mm-hmm.
But it all starts with that check, right?
Mm-hmm.
It all starts with that little, like, nudge.
Yeah, yeah.
And he has a famous line in this movie that I just love. And he just kind of, like, looks around the courthouse after he's entered in his client's guilty plea. You know,
mm-hmm.
they're not guilty.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody walks out. They say, we're going to be adjourned. We'll start our trial case, presenting evidence here
mm-hmm.
in a few weeks. Everybody walks out of the room, and Caffey has this moment where he's like, oh, so this is what a courtroom looks like.
They're not guilty.
Enter a plea of not guilty for the accused. We'll adjourn until 10:00, 3 weeks from today, at which time this general court-martial will reconvene.
Why does a lieutenant junior grade with 9 months' experience and a track record for plea bargaining get assigned a murder case? Would it be so that it never sees the inside of a courtroom? We'll work out of my apartment every night, 7:00. Joe, before you come over tonight, pick up a carton of legal pads, half a dozen boxes of red pens, half a dozen boxes of black pens. Sam, get a couple of desk lamps. I need you to start on a preliminary medical profile. And Joe, we need all the proficiency and conduct reports on Dawson, Downey, and Santiago. The only thing I have to eat is Yoo-Hoo and Cocoa Puffs, so if you want anything else, bring it with you. Okay?
Yeah.
So this is what a courtroom looks like.
And I think that's like such a tangible thing for Christians who run through their life trying to kind of like find their way through, but they're just kind of like breezing through.
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah.
then they finally have that moment in their life where they really hear from God, or they get a check in their spirit from the Holy Spirit, like, hey, be
right.
careful of this. And then they look around and they're like,
wow.
oh, so this is what it's like to hear the voice of God.
Exactly.
You know what I mean?
Exactly.
It never comes to us the way, like
yeah.
a lot of times we think God's going to write on the wall, you know, or he's going to send us 19 rainbows.
Right. It's just a simple, you know, spiritual revelation
right.
where you're like, oh, I'm on a new level now.
Right.
It's
like this little nudge and you're like, there it is.
There it is.
And you don't ever know it until like it happens to
mm-hmm.
you. But it was a very like relatable moment for him to have like that epiphany, like, oh, so this is what it's like to be in a courtroom.
Right.
And then he goes and he puts the work in.
And he puts the work in.
Yep.
Awesome. Okay. So, oh, that was good. We already kind of talked about this. I'm so excited
mm-hmm.
to hear this part. So now we're pushing in towards the end.
Yeah.
When we get towards the end, we went and watched this guy kind of like unfold all of these answers and realizes what exactly happened now. Mm-hmm. I have to prove it. Mm-hmm. How do I prove it? And he realizes that the only way I can prove that this was wrong is you have to admit it.
Yeah.
And how can I make you admit it?
Right.
So I know you know exactly what I'm talking about. And so how do you go beyond the script?
There's another element even before this that I think like ties like the spirituality of this. But you know, before they get to the point where they're gonna put Colonel Jessup on the stand, right? Which he's the top dog. Like he has the ability to bury this whole thing.
Right.
He has the ability to end all these people's careers and livelihoods. And like, he's like, nope, I'm a colonel. I'm coming up for bigger things in Washington. But there's a moment before that where the colonel's second in command, Lieutenant Kendrick, you know, they're asking him, hey, do you know anything about this code red or whatever? Mm-hmm. And what does Kendrick do? He's like, you know, I keep the King James Version Bible on my nightstand.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
This, what does he do? He flexes his
this
like
whole rehearsed thing.
Yeah, but he flexes like his spirituality a little bit.
Right.
Like
right.
somehow that makes him infallible.
Right,
like I
right.
couldn't possibly be wrong. This situation
would
can't
you
be
ask,
wrong.
Yeah. Why would
yeah.
you ask me that?
And
yeah.
there's this haughtiness. There's this like prideful attitude that basically you're introduced to as you get into the defense of this case.
Right.
And this is from the second in command. What happens whenever you get back to Colonel Jessup, the first in command? That spirit, that attitude of pridefulness is way more magnified to the point where this guy legitimately believed, I can actually tell you the truth and nothing will happen
to
me.
Exactly.
Like what type of pride have we reached where that's acceptable,
right.
you know, where
I can
that's okay.
speak that I did a crime. But
yeah, but
will
and
to
nothing
me.
Will happen to
yeah,
me.
Yeah.
That's a level of arrogance that is it kind of takes the cake, but it's a military mindset that if you're in that position, nothing can touch you. And I think what we see out of this is Lieutenant Caffey, as he's doing his cross-examination, it's really what I like because he's got so many explanations as to why his clients could be innocent, but none of those things are good enough to take down the colonel.
Exactly.
So he's got to push his chips all in.
Yeah.
He knows there's one play here. You know, there's one move.
Yeah.
And my move is I've got to get under his skin enough where he's going to have his meltdown in front of the judge, in front of the jury, in front of the entire courtroom.
Right.
And if he can't get him to that point, you know, it's not going to work.
Yeah.
And what I loved about it is his ability to go all in. I think a lot of times we get these checks and balances in our spirit. We get these nudges. We get these like pauses, you know, from the Holy Spirit. Hey, something's not right here. But we don't have the commitment to go all in.
Right.
We kind of go in like one foot in, one foot out.
Yeah.
And when you're, you know, whether you're in the military or whether you're, you know, living for Christ or whatever your thing is, you have to be all in.
Right.
There can't be a half in, half out
and
attitude
even his
to this.
Staff.
Yeah.
While you're speaking, I'm even thinking about even his staff. It made me think of Job having to go through even his wife telling him, just curse God.
Yeah.
Like, you know what I mean?
Like it's getting thick.
They were
thick.
Even telling him, like, okay, if it looks like he's not gonna go there.
Yeah.
Pull back
and save yourself.
And save yourself.
And I think that was a moment where he's sitting here going like, hey, you wanted me to get to this space.
Right, and I'm here.
And now you're telling me to like back up a little bit. I'm reminded actually of a verse in 1 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians 15:58 says basically, having done everything you know to do, stand firm.
Stand.
And a lot of times, we as Christians in particular, we feel like we're just stretched too thin and I don't know what to do. I've done everything I know to do and it's not working. So I guess I just need to like bow out of this thing. I guess I just need to like move on, try something different. And Paul, as he's speaking to the church of Corinth at that last, you know, chapter of that book, he's saying, after you've done everything that you know to do, the last thing to do is just stick it out.
Yeah.
Like stand firm in this.
Mm-hmm.
And I think I relate to this movie in that moment where you know, Lieutenant Caffey he's exposed. Mm-hmm. He's got nothing else to do.
Nothing.
His chips are in. He knows if this doesn't work, he could be disbarred for attacking like a decorated military general.
Right.
And he knows that if this doesn't pan out, you know, he could face their various court-martials, which court-martials are like the judicial system for the military. He's got a lot, like it looks bleak. Right? And
right.
he's done everything he's known to do.
Mm-hmm.
He's gotten all the interviews done. He's cross-examined, you know, everybody he can. He's taken all the notes he can. Only thing left to do at that point is just, you got to go for it. You got to stand firm in what you believe in. And I think that was like a good motivating principle that came out of that ending of that narrative. Of course, we all know what happens, you know?
Yeah.
He pushes the wrong buttons.
Right.
And Colonel Jessup orders, admits that he ordered this code red in this movie.
Yeah.
And, you know, the rest is history.
You snotty little bastard.
Your Honor, I'd like to ask for a recess.
I'd like an answer to the question, Judge.
The court will wait for an answer.
If Lieutenant Kendrick gave an order that Santiago wasn't to be touched, then why did he have to be transferred? Colonel?
Lieutenant Kendrick ordered the code red, didn't he? Because that's what you told Lieutenant Kendrick to do.
Object!
And when it went bad, you cut these guys loose!
Your Honor, you
had Marcus inside
a bony transport!
Your Honor,
you doctored the logbook!
Damn it, Captain!
You coerced the doctor!
Consider yourself in contempt!
Colonel Jessup, did you order the code red?
You don't have to answer that question.
I'll answer the question. You want answers?
I think I'm entitled to.
You want answers?
I want the truth!
You can't handle the truth! Son, we live in a world that has walls, and those walls have to be guarded by men with guns. Who's gonna do it? You? You, Lieutenant Weinberg? I have a greater responsibility than you can possibly fathom. You weep for Santiago and you curse the Marines. You have that luxury. You have the luxury of not knowing what I know, that Santiago's death, while tragic, probably saved lives. And my existence, while grotesque and incomprehensible to you, saves lives. You don't want the truth because deep down in places you don't talk about at parties, you want me on that wall. You need me on that wall. We use words like honor, code, loyalty. We use these words as the backbone of a life spent defending something. You use them as a punchline. I have neither the time nor the inclination to explain myself to a man who rises and sleeps under the blanket of the very freedom that I provide and then questions the manner in which I provide it. I would rather you just said thank you and went on your way. Otherwise, I suggest you pick up a weapon and stand a post. Either way, I don't give a damn what you think you are entitled to.
Did you order the code red?
I did the job.
Did you order the code red?
You're goddamn right I did.
So.
Wow. Woo!
That's a moment.
That's a moment.
It's a powerful moment.
I do want you to speak a little bit about, we're coming to the end now, but mm-hmm. I just wanted you to speak a little bit about how I kept seeing beyond the script, mm-hmm. I kept seeing that the colonel was, just his arrogance. Mm-hmm. It was just like, dude, if you would have just been quiet, you mm-hmm. would have got away with this.
Yeah.
But you're so arrogant
yeah.
that it was just like, no, I could tell you what I want to tell
yeah.
you, you know? And then you said something to me out there about,
yeah.
to him, it looks like he was parallel as a pastor.
Yeah. Yeah, there comes a certain point where you kind of cross over into that layer of arrogance. I think everybody has a natural amount of pride in their life that they have to manage, right? It's easy for us to, especially whenever you do get good at something.
Right.
I recall being in the military and I was a good sailor. I won awards. I was in the Navy for 8 years, and during my time in the Navy, I was definitely on the better end of what a good sailor was versus mm-hmm. the opposite direction.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a pride element to that where you tend to think like, I have reached a certain status
mm-hmm.
that says I'm this caliber of person.
Right.
What I struggled with was in particular when I got out of the military and realized that the things that I did in the military, nobody really cared about those things.
Mm-hmm.
Like, and that was me at that level,
right.
But it's not that important when you're outside of your quote unquote bubble.
Mm-hmm.
And I think a lot of times that's what you get with pastors.
Mm-hmm.
Pastors have this ability where they can bypass certain components, you know, to become a CEO of an organization. Mm-hmm. And when you do that, you start to believe that you're...
The hype.
Yeah. You believe that you're this caliber of individual, mm-hmm. that, you know, now you can provide counsel. You hear from the voice, you know, you hear from God, and you can, you know, tell people what to do for this.
Yes.
You have these abilities to interpret what's real and what's not real, or what's truth and what's not truth.
Right, right.
You have the ability to build your organization as a business, you know, and the financial capacity that goes into that.
Right.
Which is very similar to how a, you know, a military general or an admiral or mm-hmm. a colonel or anybody else in that world right. would believe. These people have this idea that because they're in that position that they're infallible.
Wow.
That they have the information. And mm-hmm. nobody else could do that. Which is completely opposite of what the Bible talks about. You mm-hmm. know, King David was anointed to be king before he ever threw a stone at Goliath.
Right, right.
And we have people like, you know, you had King Saul that literally looked at this guy and was like, you can't fight Goliath. Not a chance.
Ain't gonna happen.
Oh, you're gonna fight him? All right, use my armor.
Right, go use
my armor, because that's the only thing that works. And all the while, David was already anointed to be king.
Right.
He didn't need, like, it wasn't Anything. Dependent on his, we forget a lot of times, David's anointed to be king had nothing to do with whether he beat Goliath or not.
Exactly.
He was already anointed to do that.
Exactly.
But we have these folks in leadership positions that believe, I'm here, I know it's right, I'm now the right hand of God or the right hand of the president
or
whatever it is, mm-hmm. and they're suddenly infallible. I see those parallels because we have pastors, especially today, where it's almost cool to be a pastor.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. It's trendy.
Right.
You know, it's like, how... I have this instant leadership ability, even though I might not be fully qualified or responsible to handle this,
mm-hmm.
That makes me in the upper echelon. Now, you know, that's like the 1%, right?
right,
I have people that listen to me, that work for me, that serve me. And if I tell them, well, you're serving me, but you're honestly serving Jesus.
You're serving God.
I continue that, you know, that dialogue. And it's like, actually, you're a man. And you're a shepherd.
Yeah.
And shepherds weren't always the most intelligent people in the world,
which is
why they were associated with sheep,
right.
who are not the most intelligent animals in the world.
Right.
So for you to be a pastor is not a kingdom that you're building.
Mm-hmm.
It's a flock that you're tending to.
Exactly.
Which means you get ticks and you get bugs and you stink a little bit. And, you know, it's not this glamorous life mm-hmm. that we have, like, you know, turned it into. And you're not the end-all be-all for that as well. So there is those parallels. I think we find pastors now that have this incredible, like, boldness that is spawned out of pride and mm-hmm. arrogance mm-hmm. to say things to people or about people mm-hmm. that they probably shouldn't, you know, how do they speak into somebody's life, or how they would speak over somebody's finances, or how they would speak over somebody, you know, who's looking for healing, the way that goes into that. And there's good pastors out there, but there's also some that really are thankful to have that title. You know, there's some pastors that are really enjoying having that ability, that CEO mindset,
right.
You know?
That's a good way to put it, the CEO mindset. Well, thank you.
Yeah.
Oh my God. Thank you so much for being here.
Yeah.
Thank you for your words. Thank you. I just do want to say to... Well, this camera's there. So I do want to say to you guys, thank you so much for being here. Thank you for supporting Beyond the Script. We'd like to thank Steven for being here.
Of course.
You're amazing. Normally, I just ask my guests to give any words that you would like to give into the community, into people that would inspire and mm-hmm. help them to move on, to see God anywhere that they go.
Yeah, I would just say, like, kind of what we talked about from this movie, the first and foremost thing you do is be looking for those little nudges from the Holy Spirit. Be looking for those little, like, tugs. Sometimes things aren't always gonna make sense to us. Sometimes things don't always line up and you're like, I don't get it, but I just have a pause or a check in my spirit. You should be in a walking, you know, conversation with the Lord so that you are not shocked whenever you get those things. Like, what is that? Oh, that's God. I know that because I talk with him on a regular basis,
right?
So I can recognize that. The other thing is, whenever you find yourselves in those situations, sometimes there's nothing else to do other than just put your feet down and be planted. Stand firm in that. Stand firm in what you believe to be right. And the last thing I will just say is, like, pride comes before a fall. And it doesn't matter if you're a general in the United States Army or you're a pastor of a mega church or a pastor, you know, of a XYZ organization. But always keep your heart right in that. Pride comes to everybody, but it always comes before a fall. Remember that.
Wow. Awesome. Thank you guys once again for being here. And we'll see you next time.